Hey everyone, if you've ever looked at Task Manager, you might have seen the CPU virtualization is marked as disabled. Does this mean the CPU is a dud, or is there a genuine reason why it's disabled? Well, in general, if you only plan on gaming, then you can probably leave it off, but there are a bunch of good reasons to enable it, too. So what is CPU virtualization? Well, it's a way of splitting your computer's hardware up in such a way that can be shared with other operating systems. So if you're, for example, a programmer, you can then install Linux within your actual Windows install, and then make use of Linux's improved support for compiling and running various programming applications. Or you can download VirtualBox onto Windows, install an old OS, and then play loads of decade-old games. Although, to be honest, in that case, using something like DOSBox might be a better option, and this doesn't usually require virtualization support since it's an emulator, not a virtualizer. Nearly all CPUs have virtualization support nowadays, especially if you have an Intel or AMD CPU from the last decade or so. All of AMD's Ryzen processors support virtualization, as do many of the pre-Ryzen chips like the AMD Athlon X4 860K from a decade ago. I feel old. Pretty much all of Intel's CPUs support virtualization too, even their older Pentiums from ages ago. Where you might start to see non-virtualization supporting CPUs, though, is in some budget mobile CPUs from more than a decade ago, like the B980 from 12 years ago. This is a laptop CPU and it just doesn't support CPU virtualization. Most modern laptop CPUs do support it, though. So if pretty much all CPUs since the release of Iron Man 3 support virtualization, why is it sometimes disabled by default, like it was on my Ryzen 5900X build? Well, in rare cases, some applications can have compatibility issues when it's enabled, and in theory, it can have some security implications too. For example, a badly managed virtual machine setup could be susceptible to certain malware that sort of targets VMs, and also VM sprawl can also be an issue. I said in theory earlier, though, because in reality, simply having virtualization enabled in your BIOS isn't really a risk, in my opinion. It's a bit like viruses. They aren't really a risk to Windows users unless they take unnecessary risks and download a bunch of dodgy files from dodgy sources. So really, virtualization should arguably always be enabled nowadays, especially because Windows have recently rolled out features like core isolation and memory integrity for virtualization setups that can really help beef up security. But I guess that some motherboard makers just err on the side of caution and think that because the majority of users won't ever use virtualization, they may as well just leave it disabled. That brings us to the main question. Should you leave CPU virtualization on or off? Well, virtualization sounds really cool, so that's enough of a reason to leave enabled, right? Maybe not. In reality, if you're purely planning on gaming and surfing the internet, you can easily enough leave virtualization off. Even heavier applications like video editing don't actually require it. But if you're likely to be building software or messing around with really old applications, then using VirtualBox can be really useful, so enabling CPU virtualization in your BIOS can then help a lot. Okay, with all that said, how do you actually enable virtualization? Well, there's hundreds of tutorials out there showing this exact process, so I won't reinvent the wheel and take 10 minutes to show you exactly how to do it. But I will say that you need to enable a specific setting within the BIOS, and on Intel systems, the option is called Intel Virtualization Technology, or simply VTX, while with AMD systems, it's called AMD Virtualization Technology, or SMV. So on my ASUS B5500M Plus motherboard, I can enable a virtualization by heading into the BIOS, clicking Advanced Mode, and then Advanced to the top before clicking CPU Configuration. I then find SVM Mode, and as you can see, it says Enable CPU Virtualization. I can then exit out to the BIOS and restart. Great, so that's now enabled, and my PC will soon be hit by a wave of virtual machine hackers. Nope, it's all fine. All quiet on the Western Front. So now that's enabled, I could go and download VirtualBox and install Windows Vista. Ah, Vista, how I loved your USB prompts. Oh gosh, Vista was terrible. Moving on though, virtualization allows me to test out pretty much any operating system I want to, all from my Windows machine, which is pretty awesome. Yes, you can often dual boot, but that's a clunky approach that requires disk partitions and bootloader annoyances. The beauty of VMs is being able to spin up a new OS, test it out or do something specific on it, like building and running some software project from GitHub, and then tearing down the virtual machine once you're done with it. It's no mess, it's just simple. Another possible use of VMs was covered by Craft Computing, who demonstrated how you can use virtualization to effectively share your graphics card, turning your single PC into a multi-gaming hub. This is a pretty cool idea, and while it can be a bit clunky to set up, it could work out a lot cheaper than building two separate gaming PCs in your home. Before wrapping up, I wanted to answer one final question. What is Hyper-V? You know, the thing that's directly below virtualization in Windows Task Manager. Well, Hyper-V is Microsoft's own hardware virtualization platform. In some ways, it's a rival to software like VirtualBox and VMware, although Hyper-V runs at a slightly different level, known as Type 1, than VirtualBox, which is a Type 2 hypervisor. Basically, Windows rolled out Hyper-V to increase virtualization support throughout the entire Windows ecosystem, and also introduce native Linux support from within Windows, something known as WSL. But you don't necessarily need Hyper-V to be enabled. Some versions of VirtualBox and VMware don't actually work with Hyper-V, meaning that you then need to disable Hyper-V to support to use them. But naturally, you still need CPU virtualization to be enabled. And that wraps up today's video. I hope you found it useful. If you did, please click the thumbs up button. Please also subscribe to my channel if you haven't already, and thank you for watching.